Yeah. There's already dirt in here. Here, have some dirt. Okay, I think that's ready. Hi! I'm feeling a little bit better today. Thanks, everybody, for joining me in the grow room. I have a microphone, so now I don't have to yell quite so much. And today is going to be fun. Today's going to be fun. It's not just me yakking all over the place. I'm actually going to do a demo and show you how to do something that's going to help you in your garden this year. Yep. These are tomato plants and pepper plants. And what a lot of us gardeners do is we will start our seeds indoors. And the reason that we like to start them indoors is because, for instance, tomato seeds. You don't want to go out into your garden, dig a trench, and then put in tomato seeds and then cover them up, because you never know. A bird could come by, eat them. Something could come and dig them up like a rabbit, or you can get a heavy rain. That is a big thing. You get a heavy rain, it washes the seeds away, and then you got a tomato plant coming up way over there that you didn't even think that you had. And that can kind of mess us up. So what we like to do is we like to start our plants indoors in pots, give them a good head start, a good root system, some good nutrition, take care of them. And then when the planting time comes, generally that's after the last frost. We all have different last frost dates. Mine is around the middle of May. So I like to start my plants a little bit early. I know this is only the beginning of March, but I like to give my plants a nice, big, healthy head start. That way they're not spending so much time outdoors growing. Once I transplant them outdoors, they actually start producing. So I cut that growing time outside down by growing them inside. That's why I have the lights here. I have it warm in this room. Most of you don't have a grow room. You just have an area set aside, and that'll work just fine. Now, what I am going to do today is I'm going to do what's called potting up. I call it transplanting because I don't go for fancy terms. All that means is normally you will start your plant in a very small container. You don't normally start it in a pot like this because that would just be stupid. And starting it in a pot about this size really isn't that necessary, because then you have all this excess dirt around there that you're having to keep moist. Because if you don't keep the soil moist, eventually when it gets really bone dry, it just repels the moisture. So it's easier to start them in smaller, I call them the little plastic cups. I get these cups at Walmart and they're really cheap, and I use them year after year after year. Some people use peat pots. I prefer not to use peat pots. I just don't much care for them. I use the little cups. And so I start them in here, and then once the plant gets about the same size as the cup, now what I mean by the same size is your plant will be the same height as the little container. That's my rule of thumb. When it gets that big, it's time to put it into a container that's about 2 to 3 times that size. And I have other cups that I've been using for years. These are really ugly, old, nasty cups, but they serve a function, and I recycle them year after year. I plant them in there, and then they have a little bit more root space. And then once they finally fill out this with roots, it's approximately the time to take them outside. So then I take them outside, pop them in the ground. The plant here is probably going to be about maybe this tall, that big around, nice and healthy, ready to get a good start outside. And I'll be showing you how I harden these off when I take them outside. But I also wanted to show you a couple more things. So we're going to get to the transplant, and then we're going to show you something that I think is actually very fantastic, because it has to do with all these little props I got going over here. But first, let's do first things first, okay? Because I tend to kind of wander off, and I don't want to do that quite so much today. So let's do some transplanting, or potting up, if you're being all fancy schmancy about it. Come on in over here, have a seat over here, and let's get started, because I want to show you the soil that I'm using for this. Soil is actually pretty cool. I have so many of these blue tubs because they're really convenient to storing stuff. But in this ugly looking tub, I keep some of my potting soil. Now, the potting soil doesn't really look that remarkable. It looks like anybody else's potting soil. This has a story behind it, but I'm not going to go into that right now. This is a mixture of coir, which is coco peat, potting soil, and vermiculite. This is the type of soil that I normally use in my grow room. I've recently changed it, but I want to use up the last of this potting soil. But I wanted to show you this because potting soil is very important. The type of soil that you use for your seedlings is very important. You want something that's going to be light and well draining, but you also want to make sure that it has plenty of nutrients in it, because your plants are very young right now and they need the best possible start. What they're trying to do right now, let me show you one of my plants. This is a boxcar willy. This is a tomato that I've grown for years, and I love this tomato because it has a very rich tomato flavor. It produces prolifically, I mean insane amounts of tomatoes off of one plant. It grows very well. I've tried so many different tomato plants, and this one is the one for me. You're going to see this growing. You're going to see this little sucker. He's going to get big, and it's going to produce, and you're going to see this all throughout the season. But what I want to show you is that it starts in a very small container. And what this plant needs to do right off the bat until it goes outside is, one thing it needs to do is it needs to grow, of course. In order to grow, it has to have a healthy root system, like I mentioned before many times. Without a healthy root system, you're lost. So you have to have a healthy root system. The key to a healthy root system is what? Good quality, rich, well-drained soil, because those roots are very delicate, very small. They need to push through this soil very fast and furious and grow, because the more roots you get, the better the plant you get. The better the plant you get, the better harvest, the better disease resistance, the better wind resistance, the better everything. So the roots are the key to the plant, and the soil is the key to good roots. Hey, I said good. It's a soil to good roots. So our first thing is a good potting mix. You want to make sure that it's light, it's rich, it's well drained, and that you feed your plant constantly. You don't want to overfeed them, you don't want to overwater them, you don't want to underfeed them, you don't want to underwater them. You want to make sure you strike a really good balance. So the first tip I can give you is get a good quality potting mix. Whatever you use, start with that. The next thing is the right container. You want to make sure that your container, like I said earlier, is not too big. Otherwise, the soil around your plant is going to be dry, because you don't need to water the soil on the way on the outside of a large container. It doesn't do your plant any good. And so whenever you have a larger container, it's very easy to overwater, because you have this little tiny plant in there. You want to make sure that you get the roots wet. And sometimes there's overwatering going on. That's why I like the smaller containers. It's easier to water a smaller amount of soil. And with these cups, I don't have any holes in the bottom. That way I can place these anywhere I need to. I don't have to have a drip tray or anything like that. How I keep from overwatering them? I'm not stupid. I know that sounds really mean, but it's actually the truth. You just got to pay attention to your plants. And the nice thing about these is you can actually see the water when it goes in there. You can see the soil get moist, so you know if you're overwatering or not. It's a wonderful thing, and these cups are so darn dirt cheap, and you can use them year after year. Let me show you how I transplant something. It's very simple, right? You just sit right there and let me do all the work. This, by the way, is a tomato plant. And a tomato plant, as it grows, will put out roots in any part of the stem that's underneath the soil. That's how tomatoes grow. They're a perennial, which means they will live forever. But we grow them as an annual. An annual means it's only grown for one season. Perennial means it's grown forever. And these are subtropical plants that generally will vine along the ground. That's their nature, to grow up, fall down, vine along the ground, put down roots as they go. And in a subtropical area where it doesn't get too awful cold, these will live forever and ever and produce forever and ever. And that's actually pretty cool. But we're only growing these for one season. Now, what I want to do when I transplant is I always want to make sure that first thing you do is you put in the soil, tap it down gently. Don't tap it down too much. You don't want a big old clod of soil down there. Now, what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to make sure that you plant this to where the stem is just a little bit lower than the top of the soil, because each time you transplant it, you want to make sure you bury a little bit more stem. So we'll take a little bit of soil there, tap this down. And the day that I transplant, I do not water my plants. I like to make sure that the soil is a little bit dry, because drier soil holds together better. If you've ever done this before, you know what I'm talking about. You've watered your plants and then you said, oh, I want to transplant it. And then you take it out and the wet soil is heavy, it pulls apart. And what that's going to do is that's going to rip the little root hairs, and that damages your plant. Put your hand like this, flip it over, push in on the bottom, on the sides just a little bit, and look, the roots are perfect on this. It's not root bound. It's just right for transplanting. We flip it over. We set it inside here, nice and gentle. Now you can see that this plant is just a little bit lower than where it was in the other pot. Gently toss in some soil. Now you don't want to push the soil in, because those roots, even though they look strong, are actually very delicate and they can be damaged. And if you damage the roots, it can either stunt, which will slow down the plant, or it can kill the plant. And sometimes people will transplant and then they say, Ray, my plant stopped growing after I transplanted it. What happened? Well, that's called shock. Now what you do is you gently push the soil in. And if you want to know how hard to push, I've said this a million times before, take your finger, close your eye, and then push in on your eyelid. That gentle amount right there that feels comfortable on your eye, that's how you want to press down on the soil here. And that's all there is to it. That is how we transplanted tomatoes. You see how it's just right at the top, right here? Yep, that is exactly what we want to do. Now we're going to water this. Let me show you how. A nice gentle watering. You don't want to flood it out. Start from the outside, nice and slow. And how much water? Well, you just have to kind of gauge it. And you should be watering your plants and paying attention to how you water your plants, how much you watered this. And then you can gauge this kind of by weight too. And also, you just wait a few minutes. Wait a few minutes, let it soak it in. And then if you turn it sideways, if it's got too much water, it'll just drip right out. Nice and gentle. You just turn it sideways, hold it right there. Don't move, don't squeeze it, don't do anything. Nice and gentle. Let it do this until it stops dripping. Then you have a perfectly watered plant. You are all set. This plant is ready to go. The soil is moist, but not soggy wet. Set this aside into like regular house light for about maybe a day or so. Let it get adjusted to its new soil. Don't push this plant, okay? If you push it, it's gonna push back and it's gonna really be harmed. So set it aside, let it adjust for about 1 or 2 days and then put it back into a sunny window or in some bright light. And this plant is gonna kick into overdrive and just go nuts and start growing like mad. We'll keep an eye on this one. And by the way, you wanna make sure that you keep these plants labeled. I learned my lesson last year because I didn't label my plants. So take the cup. This says Boxcar Willie. I like to take just cheap tape. This is just cheap tape. And I wrote all the names of the ones that I'm gonna be transplanting. Toss it on here. Boxcar. Yep. Set it right here. I used to write it directly on the cups, but the problem is once you start doing that, you got all these weird names and you forget what the heck you got going on in here. A little piece of tape, you can tear that off later. There we go. Boxcar Willie is all set to go in the next stage of its growth. Okay, where are we gonna put you? We'll put you right here for right now. How easy was that? And this is actually one of the fun parts. I love this. I like planting the seeds and I like watching them come up, but I just love transplanting because I know that as good as they're doing right now, they're gonna do even better when they get into their larger pots. And that's the next stage of gardening. And then after that, spring is here and then it's time to get outside and then the real fun begins. But for right now, oh, and by the way, when you're doing peppers, I do tomatoes and peppers indoors. I start them indoors. When you do peppers, you can bury them just a little bit, but not quite as far as your tomatoes, okay? Because peppers will put out a few more roots along the lowest part of the stem, but they don't do it all along the stem like tomatoes. They really don't do it that much. So when you transplant your peppers, bury them maybe about a finger's depth deeper into the soil. And then when you take them outside and plant them again, do the exact same thing, bury them just a little bit deeper. What that's gonna do is that's gonna bring a few more roots along the stem, but it's also gonna take the main root cluster of the pepper. Each time you plant it, it goes lower and lower. So that when you plant it outside and you plant it a little bit deep, what that's gonna do for your plant is something amazing. And I'll show you how to do this when I transplant them outside. What it does is it takes the root system deeper. And a lot of people during the summer, when they're growing their plants, they notice that their plants wilt really fast. You know, the heat of the summer comes on, our plants wilt, and we're trying to keep them watered, but we got jobs, we got to be gone. What are we going to do? Are we supposed to mulch? Don't we mulch? Do we plant them deeper? Do we, you know, what's going on with the plant? Well, what happens when you do this, and this is so simple, it's a great preventative, is what you're doing is you're planting the plant deeper. And you can plant this probably a few inches deeper easily, and it won't hurt at all. Because even though it won't grow roots all along the stem, burying some of the stem, burying, there we go. You know what I'm talking about. Burying the stem a few inches underneath the soil is not going to hurt the plant. The stem will not rot. But what this does is it takes the root system down deep. And that way, when you cover it up with soil and then you put maybe a little bit of mulch on there or not, when you water your plant, you don't just water a little bit. You water it to where that water goes way down deep into the soil. And that's part of what I call the praxis method of growing. I plant them deep. That way their roots are not at the surface. And when they're really deep, you give them a good solid soaking, a real solid soaking that you normally don't see people giving their plants. You may think, hey, I'm drowning them, but you're not. What you're doing is you're taking that water and the fertilizer way down deep, and then you can walk away and you can leave your plants for days, literally for days in the hot sun. Your plants don't wilt. And that way, when everybody's out there wondering what's going on with their plants, you're inside. You're not having to be out in the sun. That is a tip, and that's a demo that I'm going to be doing later on to show you how to keep your plants hydrated and healthy. And it definitely does help their production too, because they're cruising along with the roots down in a nice cool soil when everything else that people plant normally by the book, their roots are baking and drying out. And also the upper part of the soil is generally where most of the predators are that are going to hurt your plants. You plant them deeper and those roots are a little bit farther away from those predators and they're going to survive a lot better. Okay, my tips for you. I'm just full of good ideas, aren't I? Okay, I'm full of something. Okay, we're done transplanting. Well, I'm not done transplanting, but I wanted to show you that demo to maybe help you out when you're getting your plant started, because this is the time to do it. Now, I also want to show you a couple things that I think are pretty cool going on here in the grow room, and also maybe this will help you. I'm not boosting any product or anything like that, but I want to show you what happened. Okay, in the Voodoo Garden not too long ago, remember I showed you the problem I was having with my fertilizer was going all wonky or something. Something was going on and I didn't like it and my plants didn't like it and they were all just kind of shriveling up and everything was going to pot. Well, I got rid of the fertilizer and some of the plants I changed over into new soil. That's why I got this new potting soil and then I ran into the fungus net issue. I'll get into the fungus net issue. You're going to love this part. You got to hang around for the fungus net thing. It is fascinating. But what happened is I changed the potting soil, and a lot of the plants, what I did was I took the soil out of the pot, got rid of it, repotted them into new soil, and now I'm giving them a new fertilizer. And I found this one online. I think it's pretty cool. I don't know much about it, but I read as much as I could find, and it seems like a good deal. It's called Organic BioLink. And I don't know anything about the company, their politics, or anything like that. All I know is that this is a good product and it's working for me. The numbers are NPK. NPK is nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. I don't know which order they're in, but you know what I'm talking about. Anyway, those three numbers are just 333. It's a very low number, but this is an organic product that's actually, I believe, vegetable-based. They don't take, you know, normally when you have organic fertilizers, it's like a whole bunch of fish heads all ground up and pulverized or some kind of poop or something like that. And it's all liquefied. And it's really disgusting. Well, this is hydrolyzed soybeans. Yeah, soybeans. So it is actually plant-based. And so people who want to grow like a vegan style garden and they don't want to use animal products, I think this is fantastic. I wasn't looking for a vegan product, but I thought, you know what? I found something that I thought was pretty cool. I might as well mention it to you if that's something that you want to try. And I just pour a cup of this into a 5-gallon bucket, add some water, mix it all up. You got to shake it up really good. And it really doesn't smell that bad. No, it doesn't. It just smells like fermented beans. And it's better than fermented fish heads, let me tell you. And so I mix this up and I've been using this. And take a look at this. I want to show you the difference that this new fertilizer and this new soil in combination is doing for my plants, because this is phenomenal. Take a look at this. This is really nothing spectacular. It's just called a polka dot plant. And it's a plant that's green and it has all kinds of weird little pink dots on it. That's why they call it the polka dot plant. Well, I was growing this and it was a very small plant. It was in a cup, one of those red plastic cups that I showed you. And it was doing okay. It was doing fine. And then it went to flower and then I cut it back and it had new growth coming out. So I was very happy with what it was doing. And this is one of the plants that I brought in to show you that I'm going to start growing regular house plants instead of just vegetables or crazy exotics, different kinds of indoor house plants that you can grow yourself. Now what happened is that fertilizer that I had, I don't know what happened with it. If it was my fault, the fertilizer's fault, don't know, don't care. But what happened was it started killing my plants. And what happened with this one is if you look underneath, take a look, here's the old growth. The leaves curled up. They curled up and they got really ugly and this plant looked like it needed to go into a dumpster. I felt really bad. I thought, wow, what am I going to do? Well, take a look at this. I transplanted it into a larger pot. It was not root bound at all. It barely had roots going at all. I took the soil off of it, put it into here. I rinsed off the roots and everything. I took all the soil off. I didn't just transplant it. I took the soil off, rinsed it off, put it into this new soil, and look at this new growth. It is beautiful, lush, healthy, big leaves. This thing is going fantastic bonkers. And it's a combination, like I said, of new soil and a new fertilizer that I've been using in my water. And it seems to be working wonders. And I like to show you my results because I can say anything I want. But unless you actually see it with your own eyes, you're not going to really get a grasp of what I'm talking about. You know what I mean? And this is what I'm talking about. This is a beauty, and I know it's going to be just fine. Take a look at the size of these leaves. This is something else. This is a tobacco plant, Shirazi tobacco, and I believe it traces its roots, no pun intended, its roots back to Iran, before Iran was even called Iran, and it's going good. It starts out, when you plant these seeds, the seeds actually look like finely ground coffee, and you look at them, you're like, this can't be seeds, they're just too small. And you throw a pinch in there, and all of a sudden, all these plants start coming up. And they're so anemic looking, and they're so top heavy, they actually look almost like this when they start out, like this little tiny plant. Only problem is at the base of it, it's real wobbly and it's falling over, and you keep putting a little soil up around it, hoping that this thing isn't going to die on you. And then one day, out of the blue, for no reason, it gets its mind right, it gets its roots right, and bang, this thing is growing on a daily basis, so fast and furious, just here in the grow room with no special treatment at all. I had to take it from a small cup to a large pot all at once because it was growing just that fast. Normally I would never do that, but this plant is going to grow to be taller than me, and you're going to see the flowers on this thing. It is amazing. The reason I grow this, by the way, is because the plant underneath is kind of sticky. These leaves are sticky, and you can grow this outside in your garden in just about any zone during the summer, or you can grow it in your grow room. What happens is white flies and other little things, they stick to it like flypaper. I know it's kind of disgusting, but this is a great way, and any insect like aphids, they bite into it. Nicotine sulfate has been used for many, many years as an insecticide. And what has nicotine? Tobacco. Yep. So these plants are definitely not something that an insect wants to eat. And it's definitely not a plant that an insect wants to land on, because once they land on it, they get stuck. And so it starts looking like flypaper. Yeah, not pretty, but very functional. I'm not a smoker. I know you can smoke these leaves if you wanted to. I grow this because the flowers, when you see the flowers come out on this, you're going to love them. And they put out more seeds. One plant out of one seed will give you enough seeds to share with everybody in your entire city. Yep, they put out seeds like you would not believe. And I'll be sharing these as soon as this goes to flower and I get some seeds. I'll be sending some out to you guys because I think that you're really going to enjoy growing this thing. It's a beautiful plant, grows fast, and it has function in your garden. These, for those of you who grow flowers, are called impatiens. Not impatient, impatiens. And impatiens are flowers that you normally see at your greenhouse, and they got like little flowers, white, purple, I don't know. They come in a bunch of different colors. And they normally come in hanging baskets, and you hang them on your porch to grow in the shade. It's one of the few really nice looking outdoor plants that you can hang on your porch that grow perfectly in the shade. They are designed to grow in the shade. And I thought, you know, this would do perfect in the voodoo garden. And somebody sent me some seeds for impatiens, and I planted them, and look at this. Let me get the camera down here. Actually, just let me turn it for you. Look at the stems on these. It's kind of like a rhubarb, isn't it? Yeah. They have these the most beautiful red solid stems in here, and they bush out. I haven't been pinching these back, but look, they grow out from the sides, just like when I do my pepper plants. They're doing this naturally. So they are going to be the most beautiful thick, lush, flowering bucket of cool in my grow room. I'm not going to be growing these outside. This is going to be inside. So if you want to grow something inside that's really nice, try impatiens. Think outside the box. You know, an outdoor plant like this can be grown indoors very successfully. Hey, Buck Carwilly. One last thing I want to include in, I know this episode is going a little long, but this is very, very important, okay? I wanted to make sure I mentioned the fungus gnats, because when we're growing things indoors, all we're doing, I know we can call it a lot of different things, but all we're really doing is we're simulating nature indoors. And when you're simulating nature indoors, you have to keep in mind that you're actually not really simulating nature, because outdoors, like say fungus gnats, they don't stand a prayer outdoors. They're actually not a big deal outdoors because they have a lot of predators. They have spiders, they have other kind of weird creepy crawlies that feed on them, and they just love fungus gnats. But indoors, we don't have those predators that would feed on the fungus gnats. So what we have to do as, well, with our being an organic gardener, this is what I have to do. If you use chemicals, it's one thing. You can use the neem, you can use the pyrethrin, you can use any other, a whole host of things to get rid of fungus nests. There's a bunch of different ways to do it. I choose to go the organic route because I like to go for the long term when it comes to my soil, the long term life of my soil. So I don't like to dump a lot of things into it that I'm really not 100% comfortable with, because even though the neem and pyrethrin, they're made of natural ingredients, when you start really shoving on the chemicals, whether they're natural or not, you always run the risk of disrupting that balance. And for me, I like to keep it. So what I did was I brought in what's called predatory mites, Hypoaspis miles. I know that's a fancy word. All it is these little itty bitty things, and they eat fungus nets. That's all they do. They live, eat, and breathe for no other reason than to destroy fungus nets. They are nature's answer to fungus nets. And let me show you something. I took my little camera that I haven't used in a long time, my old camera, and I put a jeweler's loop, which is a magnifier that you put up to your eye so you can see things really big. And check out what I saw inside the soil in these plants. Take a look at this.
Even though there's quite a battle going on over here in the Voodoo Garden, you really can't see much with the naked eye. Some battles are not extremely huge. They're actually very, very tiny, and a lot of them go unnoticed unless you take your time and look really close. Take a look at the combatants. Let me show you the one that I'm trying to get rid of, and I'm going to get as close as I possibly can to it. Now, you got to look close and you got to look quick because they move around really fast. Now, look underneath this plant back here. Right at the soil line, you're going to see little tiny black things flitting around. These are called fungus gnats. And let me see if I can get any on camera. Yep, you'll see a couple here and there. They fly around soil level. That's the thing about fungus gnats. They're generally right around soil level. And you can see a couple of them here and there if you look really close. Yep. Those are the bad guys. And the adults, they just flit around and find mates, and they do whatever critters do when they're not eating. And fungus gnats generally don't eat much. So they're not a problem. They don't damage your plants. It's their children. Yeah, you've heard that before. Yes, it is the children that are the problem with fungus gnats, because these fungus gnats will procreate like mad, lay eggs, and then there's these little itty-bitty maggots that you can barely see in the top inch or so of soil. And that's what I'm talking about when I go crazy and I talk about fungus gnats. The fungus gnats really don't seem to be much of a problem, but the babies will eat the little roots off of your seedlings. Whenever you're starting seedlings, oh, there's a few back there. Yeah, I know, it's just frustrating as heck to see them all over the place. And the reason that I'm not spraying them or treating them right now is that I have an ally in my soil. And let me show you what that ally is.
Normally, when you look up close in plant soil, you don't really see a whole heck of a lot with the naked eye. And that's why I recommend getting a magnifying glass or a jeweler's loop. A jeweler's loop is one of these things. It looks like this. And you put it up to your eye and it magnifies tremendously. Crazy amount of magnification. Let me show you what you can see when you put this up to the camera. This is not the best situation to film, but it's the only way I can show you what a fungus gnat, what a predatory mite looks like. Hold on. See right there? That is a Hypoaspis mite, and it's also called a predatory mite. This soil is filled with these things. They are all over the place, hundreds of them per pot. And these things run amok, and all they do all day long and all night long, 24 hours a day, they never rest, is they look for fungus gnat larvae, those little maggots, and they look for those and they eat those. And of course they mate and make even more of these things. Yep. That's kind of creepy, but it's also very hopeful. And that's why I'm not worried. You can see the fungus gnats floating around here. What I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be getting those yellow sticky traps. I do advise those if you have fungus gnats. You put those on a little tiny stick and you poke them in there. It looks like a little picket sign. You don't let it touch the soil because you don't want to trap any of those predatory mites if you have those in your soil. If they touch them, they'll stick as well. So you want to keep it up a little bit above the soil, and that way the flying fungus gnats, they're attracted to yellow. And so they will go to that and they will stick to it. And the eggs they lay will be taken care of. And the maggots that come from those eggs will be taken care of by those fungus gnat predators. And when there are no more fungus gnats in your soil, those little mites, Hypoaspis miles, predatory mites, they will eat nothing but decomposing matter in your soil. And so if you run your soil like I do and you take the leaves and you crush them up and you put them back in here and you're using a lot of organic matter, they have an endless food supply in here, and they can live for years without seeing a fungus gnat. And I never had a problem with fungus gnats. I would have the windows open, and every now and then a fungus gnat would get in, and I didn't care, because I knew that my little army was in there, and they were taking care of my plants for me. Now, when you're using the predatory mites, you want to make sure that you feed the soil and you keep the organic matter in there. Otherwise, they may slowly die off, and it's very easy to keep them alive. I hadn't even looked in my soil for so long, and then when I looked in there, when I got the fungus gnats, I realized I still had my predatory mites. So they're a really easy thing to have around. And one last thing. Remember I was doing I'm still doing them, those big, fat, nasty grubs that you saw in the voodoo garden, and everybody was creeping out on those? Well, it's really weird how a negative can turn into such a cool positive. I'm going to give you a prime example, okay? Those little grubs saved my garden, my indoor garden, because I made those worm castings, and the worm castings kind of sucked. Remember, I did an experiment and they didn't work that well? Well, I didn't know what I was going to do with them, so I put the lid on top and I just kind of set them to the side and I just forgot about it. And one day I opened up the lid and I looked in there to see if it was molding or anything, and it looked like it was crawling. So I went upstairs and I got my glasses and I got a magnifying glass, and I took a handful of the worm castings and I brought it up, and it was seething. I know, this is gross. It was literally covered in a carpet of predatory mites, because I had taken some of my old soil that had the mites in it and I had sprinkled it in with the worms to make kind of like a soil for them to crawl around in. And the decomposing matter and the worm castings was the perfect environment for those predatory mites. So I literally made kajillions of mites out of that worm casting. So what I've been doing is I put it in my potting mix and I take handfuls and I sprinkle them in every single pot in here. So I'm actually exponentially making more fungus gnat predators in my grow room, so that in the long run I'm not going to have a problem. I have some fungus gnats for right now, but I know that my little predators are going to go after them and they're going to take care of them in the long run, so I don't worry. What I've done is I've found the balance of nature in my grow room, and that's what I did. I took something from outside, and it's not an instant fix. If you want an instant fix, don't go with these predatory mites, because it's not going to work for you, okay? You're going to see fungus gnats for weeks after this. And what'll happen is, day in and day out, every few days, they make a new generation of more predatory mites, and they build and they build. But they don't climb your plants, they don't go out of the pots, they stay in there. So you're going to have to take some of that dirt, move it to another pot, sprinkle it around. Don't disturb them, don't go flooding them, don't go over caring for them. They can take care of themselves. But what they do in the long term, they build the health of my soil. So I'm actually taking nature and using it to balance the imbalance that I found in my grow room due to the fungus gnats. And that's what I like to do whether I'm indoors or whether I'm outdoors. My methods don't seem to jive with, you know, the mainstream way of doing things, but it works for me. And I'm not some kind of a weird hippie or tree hugger or tree licker or anything like that. All I like to do is I like to try to find a balance in my garden. And I find methods that I like, and I like to share them with you. Some methods I don't like, and so I don't practice them in my gardening. But this is one method that I like. I like the predatory mites, and it works for me. So the neem and the pyrethrin, I've had that for years, and it just stays in the cupboard. I don't know why I keep it. I guess it's because I don't like to throw anything away. But I do keep it in the cupboard, and I have no idea why, because I'm not going to have a problem with the predatory mites in here. They're perfectly safe. I know they may give you the heebie-jeebies just thinking about them, but you know what? In real life, nature is not that pretty, okay? Nature is always killing something off, eating something, growing off of something. Fungus is sending its roots into stuff. If you eat cheese, you're eating milk that's rotting away because of organisms. You know, if you're eating aged beef, it's because of organisms that are rotting that beef. There's a lot of weird stuff going on. I mean, people who drink wine, that's made with nature decomposing other stuff. Beer drinkers, a lot of stuff. Even our bodies are designed to do things like this. Your body breaks down things, tears it to shreds, and turns it into good stuff. And then you, whatever's left over goes out back into the environment, and nature takes care of that. That's how nature works, folks. Nature is one ugly stepchild. I'm sorry, Rascal. Okay, I need to shut up. Okay, I pretty much made my point. Now I'm just going off onto a tangent. Thank you, everybody, for joining me for this fun episode. I really did appreciate it. It's nice not having to yell. I'm glad to have my microphone back, and I'm glad to have you guys in here visiting with me. I'm just spitting up all over the place. Thanks, everybody, and have a great day. This is Rascal and Ray. Take care. Daddy's done making a fool of himself. Let's go.